Well, good morning, Brookside. How we doing this morning? Amen, right? Isn't Josh a character? I just love that kid. He's always got something for us, right? So welcome to Brookside Church. I'm Pastor Yule. I am the Director of Ministry here at Brookside and just excited to be in your presence this morning. And more than that, for all of us to be in the very presence of the Lord. And I want to open up our service this morning with prayer that we might set our hearts toward the Lord and just get ourselves prepared just to worship God today. How many ready to worship? Come on, give that to me. Yes. Yes, I am so ready to just go before the throne of grace that we might find grace and mercy to help us in our time of need. And so as I was thinking about this morning's prayer, thinking about those of you that are coming here this morning, those that are watching online, the scripture came to my mind from Psalms 34, and I think it sets us up nicely for our time of worship, because David in this psalm hits a lot of things that we have within us to bless God for. It says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all of my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. And that's the part I want you to focus on. You might be here this morning, and perhaps you've done something that you know you wasn't supposed to do, or you didn't do something you were supposed to do, and yet you think God has forgotten about you. Listen to that scripture one more time. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all of his troubles. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste and see that the Lord is good. How many have tasted and you know God is good? Amen. If you do know that, stand up on your feet. Let's go into a posture of prayer. Let's just give God glory for that as we enter into his presence and his worship. Thank you so much, Father, for this morning being here. Somebody here, Lord, this morning needs to hear from you. Somebody needs to know this morning that the blood of Jesus has covered their sins and that they no longer need to be ashamed, that in you there is no condemnation. Somebody here, Lord, needs to be set free. Somebody here, Lord, just has been set free and just need to lift up holy hands and worship you this morning. Some just came, Lord, because they're excited about that. They're excited to hear from your word. They're excited to hear that you are in this place, and they just want to worship you as a result. So now, Lord, as we enter into your courts with thanksgiving and praise, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would be welcomed here, that you would come into our presence and manifest yourself among us. We know that you're in all places at all times, but we want to see a manifestation of your grace, your mercy, your power right here in this place, so that some man, woman, boy, or girl might want to know what they can do to be saved. And for those of us that are saved, we might celebrate alongside them and just worship you. It is in your precious Son, Jesus' name, that we pray, and we thank you for this opportunity. Amen. Let's worship, guys.
Who raised the power of sin and darkness? Who's the God is worthy of praise this morning. Amen. Let's lift our voices, sing worthy. Let's sing this together.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Sing worthy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is a failing love that you would take my place. Yeah.
Guys, this week was a rough one for me. I was tired every day. I was struggling to find my time with the Lord. And I got to the end of my week, and yesterday I was just cleaning my garage and just thinking about my week and how I went through my week frustrated that things were busy, frustrated that I didn't have my time with the Lord that I wanted. And the Lord just reminded me, like, all you need is me. You need Jesus. And I was just reminded that sometimes we feel like we have to check these boxes or have this perfect schedule or not be busy or have the perfect house or whatever those struggles are. But Jesus is just saying, all you need is me. Stop striving, stop feeling like you're not good enough because you are. I'm enough for you. And maybe somebody this morning needs to hear that too. Just pursue Jesus, and he is everything that you need. In him there is joy, there is freedom, there is happiness. We just need Jesus.
Caught up in your presence, I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. Oh, I'm not here for blame. nothing else, nothing else to do, and I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else to do, and I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else.
Thank you. Thing I've made, but
it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you, Jesus. Sing that again. Coming back. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, where it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
In this moment, just surrender to the Lord. Maybe some ways that you have put other things in front of Him, idolizing other things. Surrender yourself to the Lord this morning.
Coming back to heart of worship, where it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, thing I've made it, where it's all about you. It's all about you.
Jesus, we come to you this morning. We worship you. We praise you. You are worthy. I'm sorry for the ways that I have run astray from your name, thinking I can do things on my own power. We're sorry for making a Sunday morning worship. Let our lives be worship, Lord. There's so much more praise that you deserve than what we can give in 1 hour in a morning. So Holy Spirit, we ask you to come and purify us, change us, make us new. We worship you today, Father. In your son's name. Amen. You may be seated.
Awesome. Thank David and the band just for leading us in worship this morning. Music. Awesome. Hey, I'm Josh King, if you don't know me by now. But today, before we get into the service and the scriptures, I wanted just to invite some friends to the stage who come all the way from Thailand. I want to invite the Hirschelmans up. Can we just give them a round of applause? These are our missionaries in Thailand. I'm gonna step aside. These are our brothers and sisters, and I want them to introduce themselves, and Bob promised he'd keep it very short about, he's a preacher. Just what they kind of do, and then how we can pray for them and support them. So I'll give you the mic.
He knows this is dangerous. Now, I'm Bob Hirschelman, and I'll let my wife and kids introduce themselves in a minute. But we proclaim the name of Jesus all over Southeast Asia by serving at a school for missionary kids in northern Thailand. And so here they are.
I'm Stacy.
I'm Carl.
And I'm Callie.
That was quick.
That was it. That was good. So then I'm going to invite the elders, staff, just to come on stage, and we just want to pray for them. What are just the big things that you guys need prayer for going back to Thailand?
It's always difficult to leave here and leave my mom and dad are in the back and leave our families and friends here, but particularly this year is difficult with COVID and just going back to uncertain circumstances there and borders being closed and difficult things there. But yeah, then that the Lord would just continue to bless our ministry there and sustain us as we do that.
You thought lockdown was bad here. It's really bad over there right now. So if you guys just wouldn't mind, just stretch your hands out as we just pray for them and just ask the Lord to just protect them as they go over. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much. We thank you that you are a good, good, good Father. And you meet our every needs, our wants, our desires. And God, we just thank you for the gospel of Jesus, that it is the best news in the entire universe, that proclaims that one man came down to die for us, lived a sinless life, and went obediently to a cross. And Lord, we just lift up our family here, the Hirschelmans, as we prepare their hearts, minds, body, and souls to go back to just the harvest. And what they do is so important and it's so amazing. And we've been so blessed to have them back here. But Lord, we know that you have work for them to do. So right now, I just pray over their mind, body, and soul that they would be continuously be encouraged and not discouraged, that they would continuously be energized by the Spirit, that they lean on the wisdom of the Father and not on their own. So we just love them so much. We pray as they go back over there that they can just continue to have awesome conversations and love the people around them, and love their students well. We thank you for these things. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen. And we love you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, guys, we love our missionaries, and the Hirschelmans are not the only missionary family that we as Brookside gets to partner with. We have a footprint, not just of Brookside, but of the kingdom all over the world. And so we would love the opportunity in the future to introduce you to all of our missionary families and really introduce them to you. So I'm excited to jump into week 5 of the sermon series through the book of 1 Peter. But before we do that, there's some family business that I'd love to talk with you about really quick. On a weekly basis, we offer you the opportunity to support Brookside financially and to support this ministry. And so we encourage you to do that as a way of investing in the future of Brookside so that you can be a part of what God is doing and will continue to do through Brookside in the future in this community. And so some of you have been faithfully and generously giving to Brookside for years. And I want you to know how much we appreciate that. And my prayer for you is that over those years, you have seen the fruit of that investment. Not in more money back to you, nothing like that, but in the lives changed for Jesus through his gospel. And man, that's an even bigger blessing than anything else. And so that's our prayer for you. You know, one of the things that we do is whenever we as a Christian organization need some things, we always go to God in prayer. And that's what you do as well. And we do that because we believe scripture when it says that God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. That basically means that he's really, really rich and he's got a whole lot of stuff. And that we hope that when we have a need, he will give us some of those cattle in a sense so that we can have our need covered. What we forget about the fact is God has already dispersed all that cattle on all those hills. He's given me a hill. He's given my wife and I a hill. And on that hill, he's given us, let's say, 12 cattle, right? He's given you a hill. And maybe on your hill, he's given you like 100 cattle. Some of you have a lot of resources. And so what we ask God for to provide for us things, he always moves and always takes care of things through his people. He's entrusted my wife and I with some resources. And he says, if you want to be a part of what I'm doing, then I'm going to entrust you to use some of the resources I've given you to serve this need. And so when the New Testament talks about giving, it never gives us a specific dollar amount. It always says, if you want to be a part of what I'm doing, take a part of what I've given you and use it to serve my purposes. So my wife and I, just like you and your wife, Denny, have understood that, and we are learning more and more about what that means. And I got to be honest, the more that I have given, the more that Heather and I have given, the more blessing it's become. And Jesus says, test me and see if I will not open the floodgates of heaven and pour out blessing on you. And every time we have given, it's never been a financial drain on us. It's never been an obligation that we become bitter at. It's always been a blessing. And I've just learned that there are blessings that come through joyful generosity and obedient stewardship. And I think that's what we are called to be. And that's what I think Heather and I are called to do, and just like you and Gretchen. But I want to introduce you to my friend. Denny Zimmerman is not only a friend, he's a mentor, he's a leader, he's also the chairman of our elder board. I want to ask you a couple of questions about that. You and Gretchen have been a part of Brookside for decades now.
You can tell by looking.
Yeah. you're very young in appearance. You can pay me later for that one.
Yeah.
But you guys have been so generous over all of those years. And so my question is, what is it about all that generosity that has made it a joyful experience?
Well, we were fortunate, both of us, to grow up in homes that modeled generous spirits in giving. And so it wasn't a new thing to us when we came to Brookside and got married. But just like accepting Jesus as your Savior, it finally has to be your thing. And so it became something that was important to Gretchen and I. And, you know, you look at, if you do a word study on generosity and giving and so on, it's all through the Bible. There's plenty of commands that we be generous with what God has given to us. But I really think the thing that it brings the joy to us is, first of all, it's an act of obedience. And in doing that, I find joy. It also is an expression of our thankfulness. And in doing that, it reminds us of how much God has given to us in so many ways, not just our salvation, but all of the blessings that he's given in terms of family and finances and health and so on. And we find that even though our motivation is not to get more, we get more blessing than we ever give.
Absolutely. You know, we have a very exciting vision going forward.
And I would just, before you move on to that, I just tap into that. You know, it's easy. We're talking about money a little bit here, but it's everything that we have. Our talents, our resources, our passions, as the song was, we give our all, our heart, our soul, everything. And sometimes I think we forget about that. We throw a little money at it and we think we're done. And he really wants us all.
All of us, yeah. We are his instruments to worship him. And that's why we're really looking forward to the future, because at Brookside, we want to build Jesus-centered homes through healthy relationships, your relationships with each other and people in the community that we hope and we believe will result in communities around Brookside that are saturated by the gospel. And that's an exciting, audacious, huge vision at Brookside that God has given us. What is it about that vision that really excites you?
Your excitement about it, for one thing.
Okay.
You know, I'm coming to realize that more and more this church is really a small part of what our mission is. And there, most of the people that we rub shoulders with are never going to be in this building or not likely to come on their own. Let's put it that way. And so we have the opportunity every day to make a difference in the lives by caring for them, by sharing our love, and so on. And and the emphasis is getting out there to our communities, and that's exciting to me. As we come back from the pandemic, you know, there are a lot of new families here.
Absolutely.
And that's exciting. And a lot of the families that are coming are either new to the church or they've been unchurched and they have some needs, and we're here to take care of that. And that thrust is really what excites me for the future.
And me as well, and for so many of you. And that's why Heather and I love to give to Brookside, because we believe this is a platform that God has given us to move his mission in Fort Wayne, Northeast Fort Wayne, forward. And that's what I want to invite you into, because here's the family business, guys. We're a little bit more than halfway through the year, and where we stand financially, and this is because COVID took a hit on the church, we're about 60 grand behind our budget right now. We're not panicking. We're not saying we got to cut stuff. But what I'm suggesting is that if that trend doesn't shift in the other direction, we may have to come to a point where we say, you know, what do we need to stop doing? Vision things that we can't just simply afford right now. So really the invitation is out there. If you love what God is doing here, If you want to be a part of what God is doing, this is a great time to start investing financially in Brookside so that you can be a part of what God is doing. And so there's some very easy ways you can do that if you will are willing to take up that call. And that is to get on our website and just sign up for online giving, or on a regular basis, you can just drop a gift in the office or in one of the boxes out there. But that is an invitation for you, and we would love for you to come alongside us and partner with us. And so to that end, would you pray for us, Denny?
I will.
All right.
Father, we're so happy that you are here with us today and that you are, you promise to give us all that we need to fulfill the mission that you've given to us. And Lord, I ask that in these summer months when things tend to be a little bit slow, that you will help us see the need and step and fill the gap, and that we'll be able to keep moving our ministry ahead with new vision and new vigor and new fruitfulness in reaching others for you. Lord, there are so many around us. We just pray that you would direct us as a church and individually to our neighbors, and that you will make a difference in their lives as we introduce them to you. Lord, be with us now that as we go to your word. We just ask that you would anoint Eric's lips again this morning, and that no matter where we are in our faith, whether it be we're new or we're 50-year veterans, Lord, help us each one to get something that we can apply to our lives that will make us more like you and more ready to minister and reach others with your gospel. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Denny. I appreciate that. And thank all of you for how you have been giving and been generous to Brookside for so long. We really appreciate that. Well, hey, good morning and welcome to all of you who are watching online right now. And I'm happy I get to jump into the Word today. And it's not going to be the typical sermon because we've got like 15 minutes and then we're out, okay? But I really have a word that I think will bless you today. We are in week 5 of this series. We are rounding the corner towards the end of this series through 1 Peter. And if you have not been with us over the last month, you wouldn't know that we are working our way through 1 Peter, and it is a call for us as followers of Jesus to be different. Now, if you have your Bibles, it's a great time to open them right now to 1 Peter chapter 4, okay? 1 Peter chapter 4. Let me dive in. Here's what Peter says. He says, you are called to be holy, for it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And that word simply means different. It means to be set apart, separate than, distinct from the world around you. And because Peter says, this is not our home. In chapter 1, he calls us resident aliens, which simply means even though we're living here right now, we are not of this world. We are of the kingdom of heaven. And so while we are here, we are meant to live in such a way that our lives draw the world to Jesus Christ. That's the call that we have in our lives right now. So the call to be different is not so that we can live out quirkiness so that everybody around us just rolls our eyes at us. That's not the different he's calling us to. He's not calling us to be different in other in. As such as that we're the only ones in the office who never shower and everybody else can tell. That's not the call to be different. It's to be holy. It's to be righteous. It's to live the kind of life that Jesus himself lived. And that's a power. No, here's the reason he's saying this. Whenever we as Christians say, yeah, we're going to live differently. We're going to be holy. We all raise our hands and say, yes and amen. Let's go until the persecution starts. And then we start to slide back and say, you know, I'm just going to hide a little bit, kind of stay out of the limelight. The book of 1 Peter is written to a group of Christians who are living in persecution right now. But this is what Jesus promised. In John 15, he said this, if the world hates you, know that it also hated me. And if they persecuted me, you can be sure that they're going to persecute you. In other words, to be a follower of Jesus and to live differently in this world means that you inevitably, at some point and in some way, experience forms of opposition and persecution. We just have to have our eyes open to it. Now, the reason this happened is if you weren't with us over the last few weeks, you wouldn't know that all this started on July 18th, AD 64. There's a fire that started in a stadium, and it was started and it spread and it went uncontrolled for 6 days. But when it was finally extinguished, most of Rome burned to the ground. Now, we believe that Nero, the emperor of Rome, he set that fire himself as a way to accuse Christians. And it worked, man. After this, all of the Roman world hated Christians for burning their city down. So there's an all-out war against them. Now these Christians are hunted, they're hated, they're tracked. Some of them are martyred, a lot of them are scattered. That's why Peter in chapter 1 says to all you Christians who are scattered all over the world. In the first 3 chapters of Peter, he asks these Christians to respond. but not in the way the rest of the world would respond. He's not asking them to pick up a sword and go fight. They're not going to win that battle. He's not asking them to get on social media and blast their persecutors. That's not going to work. Here's what he says. Live such good lives among the pagans that even though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and praise your God on the day that Jesus shows up. Guys, the way that we fight the battle when we're in the middle of persecution is different than the rest of the world when they're under persecution. We don't fight with swords. We don't fight with social media. We fight with a life that looks like Jesus. And the victory we're going for is not when our enemies and our persecutors are dead or gone. No, no. It's when our enemies glorify God on the day that Jesus shows up. That's what we're going for. That's what we're going for. In chapter 4, verse 1, Peter says the reason that we do that is because that's the very same attitude Jesus himself had. Listen to what he says. He says this. Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves with the same attitude, because whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. As a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. For you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. And guys, at verse 3, I got to stop and say, well, wait a minute. Where all of a sudden did sin come into the picture? This is the first time Peter really addresses sin. Where did that come from? Because so far in chapters 1 through 3, the enemy that these Christians are fighting against or experiencing is the Roman government, Nero himself. Sin didn't have anything to do with this. So why is Peter bringing in a conversation about sin right now? Until I realize something, guys, as Christians, we don't have just one persecutor, we have two. The first persecutor that these Christians are experiencing is the Roman government, Nero himself, other people. This is when they're hated, mocked, accused. This is when they're hunted down, tracked, scattered, and martyred. That's one persecutor, but we all have another one, and that is sin itself. Sin itself makes a mockery of us. Sin itself sets up strongholds in our lives and then dictates our every moment, dictates our behavior, the way that we think. It controls us. But the more you let sin create strongholds in your lives, the more a slave you are to that sin. And right now, every one of us are thinking of that sin that we simply cannot beat. That one sin that just keeps coming up in our lives and we can't do anything to stop it. It seems to control us. That's a persecutor. Sin oppresses us. It hates us. It tries to destroy us. And for so many of us, we can point to moments in our life where sin, if we have let it had its way, would have destroyed us. Some of us, we're still there. Sin is a persecutor, and it wants to conquer us. But watch this. Jesus on the cross has made us more than conquerors. He's the one who's given us power over sin. And through the Holy Spirit, we get to break down strongholds. We get to destroy the power of sin because Jesus on the cross has already broken the chains of sin in our life. We get to be free. But you know what? Even though there are other people in the world that might want to persecute us, they themselves are slaves to sin. The whole world is in a stronghold of sin without Jesus. Here's what the reality is, guys. Even though you're not a follower of Jesus, you can still see the destructive effects of sin in your life. So watch this. When the world sees that followers of Jesus have overcome sin, all of a sudden they recognize there's a power resident in followers of Jesus that's not living in anybody else. Here's what I'm learning from Peter in chapter 4, verse 1 through 3. If you and I, as followers of Jesus, want to have influence over the world that is persecuting us, so that on the day that God comes, they will give glory to him, we have to first conquer sin inside of us. Because if we don't, we're honestly living the exact same kind of life the rest of the world is. We're letting sin dictate us and have strongholds over us. And if we can't conquer those things, then we're living no different kind of life than the world around us. Here's what Jesus did. The reason that you and I glorify God is because of Jesus today. But the reason we let Jesus have so much influence over our lives is not because he had great teaching. He did, but because he conquered sin. He conquered sin and we have freedom, and therefore because of Jesus, we glorify God. And that's the same call on us. When you and I conquer sin, we have now the ammunition for the world around us to glorify God through our lives. That's the holy life. That's what it means to live differently. Watch what he says. The end of all things is near. This is verse 7. Therefore, be alert and of sober mind so that you may pray. Be alert that the way we live is having an impact on the world around us, and we're influencing people whether we realize it or not. What I want to do is then show you, now that you and I are beginning to conquer sin in our life, how we can begin to influence the world around us. I want to summarize verse 8, 9, and 10 for you. Verse 8, love each other. That's us, love each other. How do you think the world perceives it when we in the church just fight with each other? What does it look like to the world when we can't agree on anything? And all we're doing is splitting churches and we're blasting each other on Facebook. When we as a church are not united together under the banner of Jesus, loving one another, that kills our opportunity to serve and love the world around us. That's verse 8. Verse 9, it says, be hospitable. The word simply translates as being fond of guests. The word is philoxenos. That's the Greek word for it. Philo translates as love. Xenos translates as strangers. Literally, love the stranger. So verse 8, love each other. Verse 9, love the stranger. People who vote differently than you, look differently than you, speak differently than you, and have a culture that you're not familiar with. Love them. Be hospitable. Verse 10, serve in your sweet spot. Not just here at Brookside, guys, but in the world around you. Do you have any idea how much impact you would have when you serve in your sweet spot and you let God use your gifts, your talents, your strengths, and your wiring to influence other people? I mean, there's some really, really easy ways to do that, guys. Jumping into kids ministry, where all you need to do is love on some kids. Teach them about Jesus in a very simple, elementary kind of way. Man, that's easy. Serving at one of our front doors so that you can be a first impression, not just to Brookside, but to Jesus himself. Man, you have huge impact. But what about your neighbors? What about your coworkers when they're hurting? Are you stepping into that pain and giving them hope and healing? When they need something, as much as you are able, are you stepping into that need to satisfy and fill that gap? Serve in your sweet spot. If you are a follower of Jesus and you're not serving in some capacity, you're missing low-hanging fruit to reach people for Jesus. You're missing it. Serve in your sweet spot. Why? Chapter 4, verse 11. So that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. There's the idea. Now, watch this. When you and I are beginning to conquer sin in our life and beginning to love the people around us, look at what he says at verse 12. Dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trials you are going through as if something strange were happening to you. You know what I realize about this? Whenever you and I find ourselves in difficulty, what we end up doing is backing away from what we've been called to do. So, you know what? Things are really hard in life right now. I'm going to step out of serving. Now, things are really hard right now. You know, we're just not going to have people over to our house for dinner and be hospitable. We're not going to do that for a little. We're just going to get better, and then we'll do that again. No, here's what I'm learning. The best time for you and I to conquer sin, the best time for you and I to love each other, love others, and serve in our sweet spot is not when things are good and easy. It's when things are really, really hard. That's the best time to do that. Why? I want to remind you of chapter 1, verse 7. This comes from the ERV version. Listen to it. These troubles test your faith, and they prove that it is pure. And such faith is worth more than gold. Gold can be proved to be pure by fire, but gold will ruin. And when your faith is proven to be pure, the result will be praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ comes. Guys, when you and I are tested by fire, that word fiery trial, the word is pyrosis. It's where we get our word pyro. It talks about a flame that is so hot it can melt metal. Think about gold refined in fire. When you pull gold out of the earth and you burn it and melt it, it separates all the impurities and burns them off. So all that you have left is pure, solid gold. That's what fiery trials do to our faith. Consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith provides perseverance. There it is. That's James 1, 2, and 3. So when I go back to Peter, listen to what he says in verse 12 and 13. Instead, be very glad, for these trials make you partners with Christ in his sufferings, so that you will have the wonderful joy of seeing his glory when it is revealed to all the world. So when I find myself like these Christians in a fiery trial, whatever that looks like, my goal is not to exit it. My goal is to lean into it, conquer sin, love each other, love the stranger, and serve in my sweet spot. And when this happens, watch this, my faith will be proved genuine. It will be refined by fire, and I'll have an impact on the world around me. I want to show you verse 19. So if you are suffering in a manner that pleases God, keep on doing what is right and trust your lives to the God who created you, for he will never fail you. Look at verse 14. If you are insulted, you're blessed. Verse 16, if you suffer, you get a badge of honor. For these Christians, that's counterintuitive. When they're insulted, they're blessed. When they're suffering, they get a badge of honor. How many of you remember in high school these things called letter jackets? Anybody? You had to buy the letter jacket, but the only way you got that letter sewed onto your jacket is if you did a competitive sport. And once you had that letter sewn onto the jacket, you got that only because when you were running track, you had to deal with the blisters formed on your feet. You had to deal with the pulled ligaments because you were running so hard. You remember the day where you ran that race, and man, you felt like your lungs were going to pop, but you kept on running and you earned that letter on your jacket. That's a badge of honor. That's a badge of honor. Guys, how can we take this home? I just briefly want to share just a couple thoughts with you. Number one, let me encourage you to memorize James chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Memorize that, James 1, 2, and 3. Second one is this, guys, get in the game. Get in the game. Our kids have been very busy this summer in different camps and sports activities. My son, Jude, in particular, this summer he's done football, baseball, soccer, pickleball, and basketball. It's awesome. I love it. We're crazy busy. I have the privilege of coaching him in two of those. I coached his baseball, and now I'm coaching his football. I'm okay. It's little league, okay? So I don't really know what I'm doing, but it's enough, all right? Now, when I coached his baseball league, all right, we won every single game. Even if we lost a game, we really won it because it was the umpire made a really bad call and ripped us off. So even though the scoreboard said we lost, we really won, all right? Now, if you're on the other team, which players on my team are you most worried about? You're probably most worried about the kid on my team who can crank that ball way into the outfield, maybe even past the fence. You're worried about him. When he gets up, you're like, all right, everyone, back up, right? Maybe you're worried about the pitcher on my team who can not only throw it fast, but can throw it accurate. And if you don't swing right, man, you're going to get struck out. You've got to be worried about him. Or I bet you're worried about my kid. Because when Judah gets on second base or shortstop and you hit the ball to him, I mean, you don't have a chance. He's going to run up on that ball. He's going to get down, scoop it into his mitt, and then he's going to wind up like a clock, man. And as you run, he's going to beeline it to first base, and you are out. You don't have a chance. You ought to be worried about my kid when he's in the game. You get worried about the players on the team who know how to play the game and are skilled enough to make a threat of scoring against you. You ought to be worried about them. You know who you're not worried about? You're not worried about the kid on my team who's on the bench, and instead of watching the game, he's making smiles in the dirt with his water bottle. You're not worried about the kids in the dugout who are playing lightsabers with the bats, all right? You're not worried about them. You're not worried about the kid who's more interested in the free bag of Doritos after the game than the game itself. You're not worried about them. But when I look at the other team and I say, hey, you ought to be worried about my kid, Judah, because he can hit and he can field. And if he's in the game, you ought to be worried. And our God looks at our enemy and he says, man, Satan, you better be worried when Eric gets in the game. Because he's got the Holy Spirit in him, and when he gets up to preach, you ought to be worried about that. You ought to be worried about my friend Jason, and when he leads his business, you ought to be worried about that, because he's going to use his business to glorify me. You ought to be worried about my other friend Jason, and when he paints to the glory of God, and he paints with such quality and skill, you ought to be worried about the influence he's having with people around him. You ought to be worried about my friend Todd. And when he gets down there in the kids' ministry, he loves those kids so much. And those kids love hanging out with him. And he has a direct influence on them over them for God. You ought to be worried about them. Church, get in the game. You've been given skills and talents and resources to make a difference. And listen, listen. If you're not in the game, Satan doesn't have to worry about you. But if you are in the game, please understand you've got a target on your back, and he will do everything he can to get you out of the game, to disqualify you. So let's put on the full armor of God, guys, and let's get in the game. Last thing is this. Why don't you talk about this with your community life group? Talk about, you know, is there a sin in your life that's become a stronghold? Maybe your group can help you hold you accountable and help you conquer that sin so that it doesn't have to control you or dictate you anymore. Talk about me. How do we as a group, how do we love each other? How do we love people around us, even the strangers? And how do we serve in our sweet spot? What if your group served together? Jason's our group leader, and this morning he just said, you know what? What if we as a community life group serve once a month together as a group? And we just take all the entrance doors, and together as a group, we serve in our sweet spot. Why don't you talk about this with your community life group? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. We're going to wrap this up right now. I just want to pray for you guys. Heavenly Father, thank you for the morning. And thank you, Jesus, that you have come and you conquered sin and you showed us what love is and how we can love each other. And I pray that as we conquer sin in our own life, and as we learn how to love each other and love the stranger, and as we learn how to serve, may you increase our platform of influence. May you expand our influence to people who don't know you yet. So even though they disagree with us, even though they might hate us or persecute us for our faith, may they, because of the lives we live, glorify you on the day you come. Father, I recognize there's people in this room who have not yet said yes to you, and I pray that you will encourage them to turn their eternal destiny from hell to heaven by putting their faith and trust in you. For we believe what you did on the cross is sufficient to save us from all sin and death. And so we turn our hearts to you this morning. And so Brookside, it doesn't matter if you've been here for 50 years, if you've been a follower of Jesus for decades, or if you are brand new with us, would you all say this prayer with me out loud? Every one of us in the room, say this with me. Heavenly Father, my life is not my own. I ask you to save me, to change me. Forgive me. Make me new. Fill me with your Spirit so I could follow you for the rest of my life. My life is not my own. Today I give it to you. Thank you for new life. Now you have mine. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done for us. We're so glad that heaven was more populated today. And we're so glad that we have been given everything we need to not only live the holy life here, but to influence other people towards you. And we pray all of this in your holy name. Amen. Amen. Guys, thank you so much for being with us. We can't wait to see you next week. Have a great week. Enjoy the